The Euthyphro is Plato's description of Socrates as he is on his way to his own trial. So a little bit more about the setting. Socrates is going to his trial. That's the trial where he's condemned. He's found guilty of corrupting the youth and of not believing in the gods of the state, and he's condemned to death. And so it's a very serious event that Socrates is approaching, but he stops to converse with Euthyphro, who's there to go to court to prosecute his father. Now, Socrates is surprised. That's not something someone normally would do. And so Euthyphro describes the situation. His father has allowed a murderer to die. That is, his father caught a murderer and then restrained him and then went to seek counsel on what to do. While the murderer was restrained, he died. And so now Euthyphro is confident that he should prosecute his father, that that's the right thing to do, in particular that it is pious. And then Socrates, upon hearing this, is very impressed with his confidence, that he's so confident that he's going to prosecute his own father. And Socrates questions whether this is the good or the right thing to do, and then they have a conversation about what is pious, exploring philosophically the nature of piety. And so Socrates, of course, asks Euthyphro what is piety, and Euthyphro, as many often did, gives some examples. So he gave the example of prosecuting the wrongdoer without bias, regardless of the person's relationship to you. And in other words, what I'm doing. So he gives that as an example. But providing examples may help one understand a concept. It is often very helpful in that way, but it doesn't help one get to the nature of the thing in question. It doesn't get to the definition or the form, which is what Socrates wants. So Socrates is after this understanding of the form of piety, and that's what the nature of the dialogue is. It's the exploration of this question. What is piety? What is the form of piety? And so examples don't get that questions answered. And so Euthyphro provides a different response. He says the pious is what the gods love. Now, the problem here right away immediately that Socrates raises is that there is disagreement among the gods over what's pious and over what's loved. And normally when you have disagreements, the idea is that you can settle them by doing a measurement of sorts. It could be literal or it could be a figurative measurement, but sometimes when there's a disagreement, the solution is simple, right? You could count things or measure things to see who's right. You can look it up from a reliable source. So if somebody has an argument over who's taller, Kevin Durant or Anthony Davis, you go check it out. You can measure those two individuals and find out who is taller. So that's the way you normally resolve a disagreement. However, sometimes when it comes to things such as what is beautiful or what is just, there is disagreement and it's very difficult to settle the disagreement. Because even though there may be an objective answer, there's no method for finding that answer. And we should be cautious here. We want to pay attention, that there is a difference between the content of metaphysics and epistemology. And you need to keep those distinctions separate. So sometimes it's very difficult to discover the truth. That's an epistemological concern or epistemological problem, but there is a truth to discover, right? The metaphysics isn't the issue. There is a resolution. So for example, it may be difficult to solve a murder, but we know that a murder has occurred and somebody in fact is a murderer. It's just difficult sorting it out who did it. Sometimes it's difficult to assess a rock on a dig. Is this used for an ancient game or not? Now there's a truth of the matter, either it was or it wasn't, but it may be difficult to figure that out. So Socrates claims that understanding the nature of piety is just this kind of situation. That is, there is a definite answer to it, but it is hard to figure out what that answer is. Socrates doesn't claim to know the answer. So, what is the epistemological concern? Everyone's going to agree that prosecuting the wrongdoer is pious. Okay, that's fine, that's an example. But how does one determine who is and who is not a wrongdoer? That's the more important question here. Did Euthyphro's father really do something wrong that deserves prosecution? So Euthyphro's suggestion of appealing to the gods is not going to work because of their frequent disagreements. We have the Greek pantheon, they have disagreements over these kinds of things. And often what one god thinks is right, another one does not, and the gods even feud about the very things that are a concern, what's right or what's wrong. So, for example, what is justice? It seems like the gods have arguments over that. So saying that what the gods love is going to give us the answer to piety is going to be problematic because of these disagreements. So they settle on this solution to the problem of disagreement. They say, okay, Euthyphro says this, the pious is what the gods love unanimously. So this is an improved question. It's his third attempt to answer the question, but it's going to be problematic as well. Now, you see the spirit of philosophy displayed there at 9e. We're going to examine all the assertions carefully. We're going to look at these things carefully. So even though Euthyphro is very confident, he just gave Socrates the answer that he needs, Socrates says, let's press on, let's test it, so to speak. So he raises this question, and this is, for the context of the dialogue, the Euthyphro question. Okay, this is when somebody says they're referring to the Euthyphro question, this is it, at least in the context of the dialogue. We'll speak in part two about a different kind of Euthyphro question. But the question here is the pious loved by the gods because it is pious? Or is it the other way around? Are things pious because they are loved by the gods? And there's a difference here. Euthyphro doesn't understand the question, so Socrates needs to explain it. There's a difference between a thing being vide, that's just a generic term, because it's in a state of Venus, and a thing being in a state of Venus because it is vide. Okay, maybe that helped, maybe it didn't, but let's think about this a little bit more. In the one case, being in the state of having the property Venus causes the thing to be vide. In the other case, being vide is what causes it to be in the state of having the property of Venus. So we're just using the V for a verb here, whatever the verb might be. Okay, let's work this out a little bit more. So Socrates gives an example, we'll just modify it slightly. Is a book being carried because a person is carrying it, or is the better explanation that someone is carrying a book because it is being carried? Now, in this example, it's pretty clear that one answer is correct, right? A book is being carried because a person is carrying it. It's the former that is correct, not the latter. You could ask this in different ways. So we could put it in a less concrete example and talk about being beautiful. So in an old movie with Cinderella, where Brandy's Cinderella and Whoopi plays the fairy godmother, the prince asks in a song, are you beautiful because I love you, or do I love you because you are beautiful? Right? The prince is trying to sort this out, and there's a difference between the two. You never knew such interesting philosophical questions might arise from Disney movies, but you never know where you might find interesting philosophical questions. So this is similar to Jack loves Jill because Jill is beautiful. So that might be a case of love at first sight, for example, versus Jill being beautiful to Jack because Jack loves her. in the way that Stevie Wonder describes. You see, Stevie Wonder considered his newborn baby beautiful because he loved her. Newborn babies aren't beautiful. I'm sorry. I've had some experience. They're just not great to look at when they're first born. But if you love them, they can be seen as beautiful. So Euthyphro goes on and says that things are pious because they are loved by the gods. That's his answer. So he implies that this is the same thing, though. He still doesn't get this, right? He implies it's the same thing as saying that things are loved by the gods because they are pious. And Socrates says, no, that those two things mean different things, as we already saw with our examples. So Euthyphro's general initial proposal that the pious is being loved by the gods, that's the idea. He says they're the same thing. But again, we have to ask this question. Are things pious because the gods love them? Or do the gods love certain things because they are pious? Two different possibilities here. So here's the problem. Let's spell it out a little bit more clearly. Whatever has God-loveness, we'll make that into a property, is God-loved because the gods loved it. Now that's what Euthyphro claims, but he also seems to claim this. What has piousness then, piety in other words, is God-loved because it has piety, right? He claims both of those things. So if that's the case, then it seems like it can't be that piety or piousness equals God-loveness. They're not the same thing, right? One of them has that attribute because the gods love it, and one of them has the attribute because it has piety. So they can't be the same thing. Piety's not the same as being God-loved. And that follows from Euthyphro's own claim. So here's the general form of the argument. What has cuteness is cued because of cueing. And what has arness is cued because it has arness. Now, if somebody says these things, we have a situation where arness, this property, can't be the same as cuteness. Why? Because they have different causes for being what they are. So we're no closer to understanding the nature of piety. And this is a problem that we need to continue to explore in part 2.